So good afternoon, we'll get started. My name is Richard Haglund, and today we're going to talk a bit about some recording that I did with the Rado Chamber Orchestra. Well, it's a professional orchestra in Chicago, and with Mike Montanello. And so we'll do an overview of Mozart, a little bit about why we make recordings, what it is to make a recording, what the art form of concertos are, and so on. And if you, at any point, any of you have any questions, please feel free to interrupt me with any questions that you might have. Of course, we'd like to thank Pinnacle Renovations for sponsoring today's talk, for all your roofing, gutter, siding, windows needs. It's been said that writing about music is like dancing about architecture. And we can see Clara Schumann saying something like this. Steve Martin's made this quote. Several different musicians have made this quote. It's very hard to talk about something that is music, just as it would be similar architecture, dancing, a correlation. But nonetheless, we're going to talk about it. We're not going to write about it today. We'll talk about music and music making a little bit, and why we make recordings. So in certain art forms, we go to see something, we go to see a picture, and that picture may affect us differently depending on our mood, depending on our life, depending on that day, depending on maybe even the location of that painting or that picture. Music is similar, but it's not as static of an art form. So the Mona Lisa is going to remain the Mona Lisa for all time, versus Mozart. It can be always changing and reinterpreted each time it's performed. We'll talk a little bit about that. So the Rado Chamber Orchestra is a group of young musicians. Most of them have graduate degrees, either at the master's or doctoral level. A lot of them have recently won posts. One oboist has won a post with the National Symphony Orchestra. The clarinetist that played with this group won a post as a professor at Florida. So it's a lot of up-and-coming musicians in the Chicago area. And I assembled them now 9 years ago for our first concert, and we've done many different projects, including the recordings that you'll see at the back of the room. So with each ensemble that approaches a different piece of music, there's going to be a different interpretation. There's going to be a different ideas of how phrases should work, and some of those ideas are interpreted by the musicians themselves. And hopefully, if you have a decent conductor, the conductor can bring all these different interpretations together and unify them to make either a live performance, or in the case that we're going to talk about today, a recording. And we're going to talk about how these different recordings have different subtle differences, but nonetheless significant differences. Another reason to make a recording, other than to have just a different group of musicians interpret this music, is certain instruments. This is a 1720 Stradivarius violin that the soloist owned at the time of the recording. And you probably heard of Stradivarius violins. What makes them so amazing is that their sound and their texture. This was made at the height of his career, Stradivarius's career as a violin maker. And it's probably one of the finest examples of his instruments because it wasn't used a lot. It was held in a collection for a long time in Rochester, England. And that's why it's named Ex-Rochester. So its provenance, you know, is traced back to its home in Rochester, England. And it's known for its amazing projection. And you'll hear some of that in the recording that we're about to play. But that's another reason to make a recording, is to have this instrument perform the music that Mozart wrote. So when we go to make a recording, or we go to do a performance, or we go to put together some kind of a program, we want to know a little bit about the composer that we are bringing back to life. Because every time we do a recording, or every time we do a concert, we're basically bringing this composer to life today, whether it be 2017, or 2020, or hopefully 3020, we're still performing Mozart. So who was this guy? Well, this is Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart Haglund. He resides with me at the Callan Beach Club. And in the elevator, people say, "Well, what's your dog's name?" And I'll say, "Well, it's Wolfgang." And they'll say, "Oh, after Wolfgang Puck?" Or they'll say, "No, after Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart." So But who was Mozart seriously? He was actually baptized Johannes Chrysostomus Wolfgangus Lopez Mozart. So that's his actual baptized name, but we just know him as Mozart or Amadeus if you watch the movie. But he was born in 1756 and lived to 1791, so pretty short life. The most common research thinks that he had a hyperthyroid condition that led to his early death at age 35. So, what was his place in music history? That's another thing that we want to look at before we start recording or performing his music, because that can influence the conductor's interpretation of the music, and it can influence the musicians, how they might interpret music as well. So we kind of start, this is a musical timeline of the different eras of musical history. And if you've studied art, you notice that it's not quite the same. So art history is usually a little bit more forward-thinking than music history. This takes the population longer to accept art. So we kind of look at music history timeline a little bit differently than we would with the visual arts. 476 is significant because that's the earliest known opera, Orpheus in the Underworld. Leading up to 1475, that's kind of the medieval period of music. And then we move into the Renaissance, 1600. And then 1600 to 1750, that's kind of a significant date, 1750, that's the death of Johannes Sebastian Bach. And so that's kind of what we call the end of the Baroque era. But of course, with all these eras, there's melding in between. But if you remember, Mozart's years again were 1756 to 1791. So he's right in that classical chunk of music history. And something about his DNA, I think, was programmed for him to be a genius with music. And it wasn't just his training by his father. It wasn't just the circumstances of the people he studied with or he was around. I think there's just something he was built for the classical era of music making. And if you study a lot of his music, a lot of it follows into a form. It's kind of a form of sonata form or a certain compositional form. And his classical music making and classical compositions just fit beautifully in this time period that he lived. If he were to be born today, he might be a computer programmer or a stock trader, or I don't know. But he was just designed for that classical era of music making. So now we have to kind of narrow down, once we decide what music we're going to perform of Mozart's, we want to kind of narrow down, where was he at the time when he wrote these violin concertos that we were going to talk about? Well, at the ripe old age of 17, in 1773, he was employed by the ruler of Salzburg, and the Prince Archbishop, actually. And he employed Mozart at age 17 to just be the court music director, if you will. And between that specific appointment, 2 years later, at 1775, at the ripe old age of 19, he just all of a sudden decided to write 5 violin concertos, and he wrote them in a very short time. He wrote them between April and December of 1775. So 19-year-old Mozart, this is similar to what he looked, this is where he lived when he was working for the court. But he looked something like this. And according to his dad looked at this portrait and said, it's not really a work of art, but it's definitely what he looked like at that time. So 19-year-old Mozart pumps out these 5 amazing violin concertos, the last 3 of which, concertos number 3, 4, and 5, have become standard of any soloist repertoire. But we're going to talk about specifically concertos number 1 and 4. After he wrote these 5 violin concertos, he never wrote another violin concerto. It's unusual. So there was a good concertmaster in his orchestra, and he might have been influenced by that, but we think that he himself played these concertos at the court. The first concerto he wrote in the key of B flat major, which is a little unusual. Notice the other ones are D, G, and A. These lay very well on the instrument. They're normal keys. But he chose the first one to be in B flat. We're going to listen to different excerpts of that. And the other one we're going to examine is his 4th violin concerto, the D major. Again, all these written in a short period of time, and we believe that many of the cadenzas, which is like a little moment for the violin to show off, were improvised by Mozart. Because there's been different interpretations of the cadenzas within these concerti. So let's start listening to this music rather than listening to me. Searing with the New Philharmonic Orchestra, and this is with a conductor by the name of Sir Alexander Gibson. Let's listen to this first movement, and then we'll listen to the Rado Chamber Orchestra that I did with Michael, and we'll talk a little bit about the subtle differences, and maybe you guys can listen carefully and notice some of the differences as well.
Thank you.
Quiz time. Anybody notice the difference between the first and second recording? Any subtleties? Not in your head, Gene, anything specific that you heard?
The timing?
Sure, the tempo. The tempo is probably the most dramatic difference. So when Mozart writes something allegro, allegro means to walk, like a brisk walking tempo. And so to a musician, Lauren walks incredibly fast when she walks around the lake. She wins me when I keep up with her. So her sense of allegro is probably a lot faster than my sense of allegro. Or if I'm waking up in the morning and walking Wolfgang, then my allegro is going to be even slower yet. So that's the very glaringly different interpretation of the same piece of music. And how we approach the tempo can really influence the effect the music has on the listener and can change the mood, if you will, of the piece of music. The phrasing, so some people speak with an accent, some people will be more monochromatic with their delivery of speech, but you can change the musical phrase just as you could the human speech. So if I say, I'm going to go walk my dog, I'm going to go walk my dog. That's two dramatically different ways to say the same thing, and we can do that with music, even within the same tempo. Specifically though, what I was going for that I haven't heard in a lot of other recordings is what I call brush spiccato. And a lot of classical interpretations of Mozart's work, and specifically this violin concerto, can get very short and just kind of tick. And there's a lot of this background, and it's kind of harkening back to the Baroque era of music with this kind of figured bass or continual accompaniment towards the violin can get very angular and kind of choppy. And what I was going for is more of a softer brush sound. And so that's something that if you were to really analyze that introduction specifically, that comes through. Let's look at another movement. This is the second movement. So violin concertos of the classical era are positioned in three different groupings. And it's usually fast, slow, really fast. And that's kind of the three movements. Early symphonies, if you're familiar, symphonies typically are in four movements, but the concerto usually falls into this three movement realm. And that's why some people don't know whether they should clap or not after the first movement. In Mozart's time, they probably did clap. They probably clapped after every movement. This is the second movement. Now this is Kremer with the Vienna Philharmonic, conducted by Nicholas Horncourt, who's world class. But let's listen to their version, and then we'll see if we can identify any differences between theirs and the Rado Chamber Orchestra.
Thank you.
shake in the soloist's hand. It's called vibrato. And that's something I want you to listen to very specifically, because in this moment, I think you can really see how a soloist can affect a different interpretation of the same music, the same notes. But now let's listen to how Michael and the Arado Chamber Orchestra approaches the second movement of this concerto. Projection of it, the note intensifying in volume. And that's done often through vibrato. And so by starting the note with little vibrato and then intensifying the vibrato as you extend that note, it really gives a sense of motion, a different motion to that work. Also, dramatic differences in tempo and in phrasing again. And that lyricism. I find Michael's interpretation a lot more lyrical than Kremer's interpretation. So it's those are the striking differences for me. So the third movement, the final movement to this first concerto. Yes,
You talked about fast, slow, and very fast. So yeah. That's considered slow. That is slow?
Yep, this is the slow movement. So this is the second movement. And again, I'm just playing a couple minutes of each movement. So each movement is, you know, between 7 and 8 minutes. Grab a CD on your way out. You can put it in your car or you're at your house or whatever, and you can listen to the whole thing. But all of the concertos follow this fast, slow, really fast kind of form. Now, something unique about the fourth concerto we're going to talk about that's in a rondo format. The other thing that's very that you'll start listening to as you listen to the CDs is that all the guitars kind of have the same form. The orchestra makes a little introduction, just like if you were to write a paper, you kind of write a little introduction about what you're going to, you know, write about. And then you have the main body, and then you might take that idea, that body of the paper, and you might develop it even more. So you have the introduction, the main body, the development, and then you might surmise everything that you talked about at the end of a paper. It's similar in the form of musical structure. You have the introduction, you have the development section, you have the main body of the section, you have the development of what you worked on here with the musical form, and then you have the recapitulation at the end of everything. And the concertos follow that similar format. There's a little moment in each concerto, it's called a cadenza. And that's where just the soloist is featured. And that's very typical in all of his works as well. In fact, in the concerto form, you see cadenzas. And then right at the end of the cadenza, it's usually the recapitulation and then the coda or the tail of what the composer's written. So that's the second moment. Now let's go to the third moment is even faster than the first. And so, but I think again, you're gonna notice between Searing with Sir Gibson and Michael's interpretation of what that fast is will be different. But what I'd like to have you listen to in this specific excerpt is phrase ending. So as the orchestra might play, or how they end those phrases, because it's very different between the two orchestras and the two conductors and what we were trying to bring across within Mozart's composition.
Hey Gary!
Hey! Oh, yeah.
Nice ride!
Oh, thanks!
What?
These are all YouTube, so they're free, but they... same editions, just totally two different ways to approach the same art form. Let's go to his fourth concerto. And this world-renowned violinist Yitzhak Perlman and Jamie Levine with the Vienna Philharmonic. But here again, I'd like you to listen to how something specifically is approached, and that is how the trills are approached. There's a lot of different ways to approach what's called a trill, and it's an ornamentation on the top of the note. And the way the Vienna Philharmonic does it versus the way we decided to do it is strikingly different. Also, you can hear the phrasing be significantly different too. But let's listen to Jimmy Levine with Yitzhak Perlman here. This is the fourth concerto, the first movement of the fourth concerto.
Thank you.
softer, more rounded introduction, and more of a lugubrious sound, more of a mushy, sentimental, softer sound, and hopefully that comes through. Conversations, if you will. And so you'll hear the introduction, but it won't follow through the same way we've heard the other introductions. So that's the last movement, but it's in a rondo-like form. So it's one section and then kind of an antecedent and consequent section, just like you would have an antecedent and a consequent construction to a sentence in English. There's kind of two different distinct sections that Mozart plays with, and it's almost kind of a dual polarity. The soloist, in a way, is almost having a conversation with the orchestra in itself. Let's listen to two different versions of this. This is a BBC Proms orchestra. Changed it. Thank you. So it's a wonderful moment because it's dialogue. You can almost hear it's almost like two people speaking throughout that. And it's very creative of Wolfgang to do that. We've been listening to chopped up sections. What I'd like to do is wind up the presentation with listening to a complete movement, and that's the third movement of the first concerto. And things I'd like you to listen for is how the musical line is shaped and how the accompaniment is articulated specifically. So, meaning that you have the solo line over the top, but listen to the underlying portion of that and not just the predominant line. Listen to the underlying accompaniment. And I think you'll open up your ears in a different way than maybe you would have at the beginning of this lecture, I hope. This is, again, the first concerto, 6 minutes, 47 seconds. Rarely do we get to just sit and listen for that length of time without getting distracted. But hopefully nobody's cell phone goes off. We can listen to it.
Thank you. That I really liked in your recordings was a lightness and an agility that I didn't necessarily hear in some of the others. Part of it maybe due to recording techniques, obviously. Was there a difference in the size of your ensemble as opposed to some of the other recordings?
Yeah.
Because like if I go to hear the same concerto at St. Paul Chamber Orchestra and the same thing at Minnesota Orchestra, two very different experiences.
Exactly.
So I was just curious what your...
So I think a lot of things went into that. Our engineer, Ryan, is, and he was the same recording engineer on all those. So he was cognizant of the lightness that we were going for. So our ensemble, my string makeup was due to the typical layout of the Rado Chamber Orchestra, but it also, very honestly, has to do with budget issues because I would love to have big orchestras. Every conductor likes really big orchestras to work with because it's a really big sound. But certainly in Mozart's time, the ensembles were smaller, and especially the court, from what we can decipher from whatever musical archaeology or musicology. But our makeup was 6 first violins, 5 second violins, 4 violas, 3 cellos, and 2 double basses. And you could go a little bit smaller with that. St. Paul Chamber has at times, they've gone down to as little as 1 double bass, and then, you know, so it's like 4-3-2-2-1. I've seen that. And I've seen Minnesota Orchestra perform Mozart Violin Concerto with 12-8, you know, 10-6-4, whatever double basses. So, but typically now, the normal performance practice for Mozart is the smaller ensemble, not the big full blown. Also, I think that the German tradition has taken a lot of the classical era composers and made it romanticized, kind of their sound and what they were going for. And even the it comes into very subtle issues like vibrato. Vibrato really wasn't used a lot in the classical era, but we use it all the time, and maybe we overuse it now. The other thing to consider is the instruments themselves. Although we did this on a 1770s Stradivarius violin, when that violin was made, it was made for gut strings. Strings are made from catgut. And hardly anyone performs on gut strings anymore because they don't produce the same kind of sound, the same kind of projection. So there's all sorts of nuances, but I think you're onto something. That we were trying to do is a small ensemble, very light, very smooth, not choppy, and elegant is what we were going for on our recordings of Mozart. So, any other questions, Jean?
Did the use of the Stradivarius, was that helpful in getting that soft sound?
I think not so much the softness of that, but I think the Stradivarius is, you can hear how his instrument projects so easily over the orchestra. And it's never, some of the other recordings, the soloist is a little bit more muted or a little bit more dulled, and our, with that Stradivarius violin, Michael just, it goes right through. And I've done other recording projects and performance projects with him where we've done, for example, the Beethoven Violin Concerto, and that was with a big orchestra, and his sound just cuts right through even the larger moments because of the instrument's qualities. Well, I encourage you to all grab one, two, three, or four CDs, and if you want to make a donation, I'm going to just throw that to the library if you want to give a free will donation. And if you have any other questions, please, I'm right here. So thank you so much for your time today. Have a great day.